Good morning, Chowchilla First Assembly of God. Pray that the Lord is with you today, and we're glad that you're joining with us to worship the Lord together and to hear from His Word. And so I invite you to ask the Lord to prepare your hearts to worship Him and to prepare your hearts to receive from Him today. So we're going to begin with an opening word of prayer, asking that the Spirit of God would work in our hearts and lives today. And let's just anticipate that He's going to do something in our hearts and lives. Father God, I thank you and I praise you for who you are. I thank you for your grace and for your mercy. I thank you for your compassions that are new every morning. And Father God, I thank you for this opportunity that you've given us this day to worship your name together, even in the environment that we are in the virtual world, as it were, with Facebook. I pray that your Holy Spirit's presence would be in every home, every place where people are listening to this Sunday morning service, God. And may your Spirit speak to our hearts today as we need to hear from you. But Lord, also let us prepare our hearts to come into your presence and give you the worship, the glory, and the honor that you deserve. Thank you so much for who you are. And thank you for your grace and for your mercy. Thank you for being the God that loves us so much that you gave your only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Worship team, lead us to the Lord. Our God is faithful forever, and we can hold on to that fact that He is with us with an outstretched arm. He is strong, and He is with us, and we can rejoice in the Lord. I will not be on the platform for these announcements that are coming up. I'm back here in the sound booth helping out with the transition of songs and things of that nature. But the first thing I'd like to just mention, again, thank you so much for your faithfulness and your tithes and offerings. During this time, since we are not having in-person services or drive-in services, we're asking that for those of you who are desiring to give to the church, you have several different options. There's three ways to give right now. You can give online at childfirst.com. You can also drop it off at the church Monday through Thursday between 9 a.m. and 1 p.m. Or you can send it in by mail to our P.O. Box 248, Chowchilla, California, 93610. Again, I want to express my appreciation, our appreciation, speaking of the church, for your faithfulness. There's some announcements that I would like to share with you today, and there's several here that I need to mention just so that you're aware of them. The first thing is the Women's Prayer Group, which meets Wednesday morning at 9 a.m. in the playground out behind the church here. They have quite a bit of shade, and permitting that the air quality is decent, we'll be meeting on the playground. If not, we'll have other options, and we'll let you know what those are for those who are attending on a regular basis. But I want to encourage all women, if you have that time free, to please come and be a part of this prayer meeting that's going on, and we're just believing God to work and move through the ladies of our church so that needs are met. We also have our Wednesday night Bible study at 6:30. We go live here from the church sanctuary, and we've been studying the book of Romans, and we're in chapter 10 now. We finally have gotten through chapter 9, and we're going to be looking at chapter 10 and moving forward there. And so I'd like to invite you to tune in at that time as we continue to study. And chapter 10, I tell you, is absolutely loaded with some awesome stuff about salvation. And I want to encourage you to take the time to tune in and listen if you're able to. If not, you can go back and review it later on if you're not able to join us at 6:30 on Wednesday evening, but you still have access to the video. I want to say a big thank you to all those who have been who came out yesterday to serve the church and helping us with the Humboldt property, the house right behind the church here. We were able to move further along, getting things cleaned up and prepared for the renovation that will begin sometime towards the middle of September. And deep cleaning is what I called it. There's still a lot to be done, but with your help, we have moved so far beyond. And I'm so thankful for all those who came out to be a part of that. An important announcement for next week. Next Sunday morning at 8:30 a.m., we're going to have an in-person outdoor worship service. We are moving to the playground lawn in the back. We're going to be setting up easy-up canopies that people can place their lawn chairs under or their camping chair under for shade. At that time in the morning right now, it is getting cooler, and so it should not be as warm. We'll have a couple fans going just to provide some air circulation. And if we don't have enough pop-up canopies, there's also quite a bit of shade around the swing set that goes all the way up until 10 o'clock before the sun finally crests the tree that's providing a lot of the shade for the playground. Anyhow, I want to invite you all to come and to be a part of this special service that we're going to be having next week. It's our first in-person outdoor service. And we invite you to come. Again, bring your lawn chair or your camping chair, and let's worship the Lord together. We'll be outdoors. It's not like being in your car and seeing people and waving at them from a distance, but here we'll have a little bit more connection. We'll endeavor to abide by social distancing and all that. We're asking people to bring their mask. It's really up to you whether or not you want to wear it in this particular context, but we invite you to be a part of this particular event. Don't forget, next Sunday at 8 a.m., we're going to be meeting in the church playground on the lawn there. Mikael and Ruth Mueller arrive Friday evening, Lord willing, if everything goes well with their flight from Paris all the way to San Francisco. So we are looking forward to having them come. I'm not sure if we'll be able to introduce them next week due to the simple fact that they may be under quarantine required by the United States government for a couple weeks. We'll see. Or I may introduce them from a distance. I'll have them come out and you guys will get to see them and have an opportunity at least to wave at them. And then hopefully very soon they'll be able to dive into the work that they're going to be doing here in the church, the ministry that they're going to be performing here in the church. The next announcement is that the Humboldt Property Renovation Project is what I would call it. We're anticipating the cost will be around $7,500. We want to invite you to pray and ask the Lord how you might be able to partner with the church in seeing this money and this renovation project raised for the money and the project to be completed over the next 2 months or so. We have painting, we have flooring, we have cabinetry work that needs to be done, and we're doing electrical right now, trying to get everything up to where it needs to be. And so baseboard, there's just a whole bunch of things that are going on here, and we invite you to participate. If you feel the Lord leading you, make sure that you put on your giving or memo, however you give to the church. If you're designating it for this project, put Humboldt or HPR, Humboldt Property Renovation, okay? And so we invite you to participate in that. And the last announcement is next Sunday, we're going to be having communion out in the playground area for those who are present. And we invite all who are joining us on Facebook to be prepared to participate in communion with us, to have some juice and some type of cracker or bread available as we commemorate the Lord's death, burial, sacrifice for us. So that's all I have for announcements today. I'm going to turn it back over to the worship team and allow the Spirit of God to continue to lead us into His presence. And remember, folks, this is our time to worship Him.
Thank you. our gratitude this morning. Oh, Lord, hear our gratitude. Because of who you are, I give you glory.
Worship you because of who you are. You're our Lord and our Savior. You have paid the price that we might have life abundantly and eternally in you. I thank you so much, Father, that you are our provider, that you are our healer, that you are our Prince of Peace. Lord, that you're doing your work in our hearts and lives as we keep our focus and attention on you and not at the circumstances surrounding us. Yes, Lord, we need to be wise to what's going on in the world around us today. But Father God, we're not called upon to live in fear of what's going on. We're called to live in faith. To live in faith, believing you that you're able to do, even in the midst of these troubling times, great and mighty things. We can trust you. We can rely on you. And we give you the praise and give you the glory that you so rightly deserve. Father, I know that there are some right now that are tuning in. And Father God, their hearts are heavy. Their hearts are heavy with the circumstances that they're personally living. God, they're struggling. some financially, some with their health, others with relationships. And God, I pray that right now in the name of Jesus, that they would turn those circumstances and situations over to you, and that your Holy Spirit would minister to them, and that you would touch them in the depths of their heart, and God, that you would manifest yourself on their behalf. Lord, that the anxiety would be replaced by your peace. They don't have to be anxious for nothing. As you take care of the birds in the sky and the flowers in the field, you consider us even more important, and your word tells us in Matthew chapter 6 that you will take care of us. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, Jesus, you told us, and all the things that we have need of will be given to us, will be provided for us. God, be with your people wherever they're at right now, and let your spirit work and move in their hearts and lives. In your precious and holy name, I ask these things. Father, I come to you this morning for the prayer needs that are evident in our church. Father, we want to persevere in prayer. We want to continue knocking at the door of your grace and your mercy. We want to ask that your Holy Spirit would work and move God and Brother Kenny Marsh's life and in his body. As the doctors have been sharing things with him that have that are concerning, that are disconcerting in the natural sense, Father God, I pray that your peace would rest upon Brother Kenny and upon Sister Esta. God, that this couple, as they have already testified this week to me in a conversation, that they are keeping their eyes focused on you. And God, I pray that you would build them up in their faith to continue believing that you're working in them, and that there will be a complete healing and restoration in Brother Kenny's body, that this cancer would be eradicated by the stripes of Jesus that he bore upon his back as he went to Calvary. And Lord, I pray likewise that your Holy Spirit would work and move in a very powerful and very real way in Barbara's life, this cousin of Sister Juanita. Father God, got another report this week, another test done, and another disappearing of cancer. Spots disappearing, others shrinking. Father God, we hold to your unfailing hand and unchanging hand, Lord, believing you to restore Barbara miraculously. Lord, that you would manifest yourself on her behalf, and that you would bring healing, complete and total healing of this cancer that she is battling against. I know that you're able to do it, and I ask, oh God, that you would. Father God, I pray for Sister Wanda's daughter, Lori, and I just found out last night that Lori's husband is also battling with cancer. And Father God, they have a 22-year-old and a 19-year-old child, two children. And God, I just pray that you would work and move in this couple's life, that this son-in-law would lift his eyes to you and receive from you a healing touch in his back, oh God, as this cancer has attained his spinal column. I know that you're a God who's able to replace the cancerous cells with healthy cells. And God, I pray that in the name of Jesus, by the stripes that Christ bore upon his back, that you would work on his behalf and do the same for his wife, Lori. Manifest yourself. I don't know their spiritual condition, but you do. And I ask that, Lord, in the midst of this trial in their lives, as they're looking eternity in the face, that they would look to Jesus and find hope for the present, knowing that in the future they will be with you forever. And God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would work and move in Sister Capehart, who's in the hospital today, struggling with issues regarding her heart. And God, I just pray that you would strengthen her and build her up. And God, that you would do your work in her life. Be with Brother Capehart as well. Father God, may your spirit continue to work in his life. May you accomplish your will, your way, in their circumstances. And I know, Father God, that, Lord, they have a sense or a feeling that their life still has value in touching their own family members as well as touching others with the truth of Jesus Christ. And Father God, I pray your blessing upon them in Jesus' name and healing work. Lord, I pray for Nicole, that your Holy Spirit would work in this young lady's life, the daughter-in-law of Brother Kenny and Sister Esta. Father God, who is still in the hospital or actually in a care facility right now. Lord, a place that people go between the hospital and arriving back at home. And God, I just pray that you would touch her where she's at right now. God, in the name of Jesus, reach down in her circumstance and restore whatever was damaged in this accident that she had. God, manifest yourself on Nicole's behalf for your glory and for your honor in the life of her husband and her children. And Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would work with and move in Gail Duncan's daughter's life, Erica, who was a part of this church for a number of years as a young lady growing up, and now is working south of Fresno, Father God, in a nursing home, and working with patients who have been diagnosed positive with COVID-19. God, she has a heart full of compassion and desire, Lord, to reach out to them and to minister to them. It is my prayer, Father, that your Holy Spirit would work and move, and that you would manifest yourself in protecting her. Place your hedge of protection about her. I ask and pray in her colleagues that she works with, and touch these folks that she's ministering to, and bring complete healing and restoration. Father God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would work and move in Shelby's life. We continue to pray for her, Father God, this young lady, that your Holy Spirit would touch her in Jesus' name, and that you would manifest your love and your grace in her life, and that you would surrender completely and totally, Father God, to your lordship in her life, and God, in this whole process, a complete physical restoration. Father God, I pray likewise for our sister Murphy, Father Sathina. God, I just pray that you would continue to be with her. She's gone through these procedures, medical procedures regarding her heart. I pray that in the name of Jesus, your Holy Spirit would bring a healing touch to her, completely restore her, Father God. I thank you for this woman, this dear woman who has served our church for so many years, Lord God, as secretary. And God, I just pray that your Holy Spirit would minister to her. Father God, I pray for L.J. Carter. This young man, a part of our church in the past, Father God, has injured his knee and he's in a lot of pain. And God, I just pray for complete and total restoration in Jesus' name for him. Reach out to him where he's at. And God, there are several individuals that have been dealing with asthma and other issues as a result of the poor air quality, the smoke in the air. I think of Dan Molina, Father God, the son-in-law of Sister Gregory. He needs your touch in his physical body. And God, I pray that you touch his spirit, that you touch his soul. I pray also for Nathan, Sister Gail Duncan's grandson. He needs you, Father God, as he's this young man of 9 years old, 10 years old, is struggling also with asthma. God, I thank you that the air is clearing up. We still have a little ways to go. And I just pray that in the name of Jesus, your Holy Spirit would work and move in a very real way in these lives. And Father, we've had a brother in our church asked us to pray for James Carr. God, he's over in the Bay Area right now, and he has had at least 2 surgeries that I'm aware of, maybe even more, because of a brain tumor. And God, I don't know this gentleman, but you do. And I ask that in the name of Jesus, in the mighty name of Jesus, you would visit him in that hospital room where he is at this moment. And God, that you would restore his health. This tumor would just simply shrivel into nothing. And God, that there would be a complete restoration and healing. Lord, when I read the Gospels and I see you walking amongst the people, and your heart was moved with compassion for those who were hurting, and you reached out your hand and you touched and you spoke words of deliverance and healing and restoration, God, I pray that this would happen in James' life, that he would sense your presence entering into that place. Manifest yourself, Lord, in his life, I ask and pray. And Lord, I pray for the Yates daughter, Julie. God, I don't know this woman. I don't know exactly what's going on and all the details, but I know she's battling with cancer. Father, there seems to be a lot of cancer out there right now, attacking people and destroying lives or attempting to destroy lives. And God, I pray for Julie that your Holy Spirit would work and move in a very powerful way in her life. And God, when I think about all these individuals that we prayed for those who are believers that I know for sure know you and love you, Father God, we hold on to faith in you to work and move in their hearts and lives. For those who I don't know whether they're saved or whether they have experienced salvation, that's the most important thing. But Father, they could be healed from their disease and still be separated from you for eternity. And God, I pray that in the name of Jesus, your Holy Spirit would reveal yourself to them, and that they, if they have not committed their lives to you, that they would, Father God, and that they would surrender to your Lordship. And Father God, that you would work your work in their lives. That they wouldn't come to you just to get healed, but they would come to you because they know they have need of you for their sins to be forgiven and to be restored in right relationship with you. Father God, do your work, I ask and pray. And Lord, as I close this time of prayer, I ask that your Holy Spirit would work and move in our nation. Our nation needs you desperately. Father, we're gearing up for the run-up in 2 months, just a little over 2 months to the election. We're almost 8 weeks away. 8 to 9 weeks, Father. And this election is so important, Father God, because we can really see the forces of darkness and the forces of light. Lord, very clearly. There's very little gray area anymore in our society, in our nation. You're either on the side of Christ, the side of you, Father God, or you're on the side of the enemy. And Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would work and move in this nation, that there would be a powerful spiritual awakening, Father God, in the hearts of people all across this land. The enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy. Jesus, you said that to us in your word. But you also said, I have come to give life and life more abundantly. And Father God, I pray that in the name of Jesus, you would work during this time. All across our land, cities and various states are struggling with constant rioting or continued rioting. God, I just pray that in the name of Jesus, somehow, some way, you would intervene in those circumstances. Protect those who need protecting. And God, I pray, convict those who are not using the authority that they've been given by the population that they're serving. They've been standing back and allowing this stuff to happen without taking the necessary steps to bring peace. And even those prosecutors who are using and abusing their power by saying they'll prosecute this, but they won't prosecute that. God, that they would follow the laws of the land and not the laws of their own heart. God, we need you. We need your grace and mercy. Manifest yourself during this time. And we pray for our president, that your spirit would place your hedge of protection about him, body, soul, and spirit, his mind, oh God, in the name of Jesus. You're the one that establishes those in authority and leadership in government. Father God, we cry out to you for mercy. In Jesus' precious name, I ask all these things, knowing that you will answer according to your will, so that you are lifted up and glorified in the lives of every person mentioned, and even in this great nation of ours, in America. In Jesus' precious name, I thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. Receive from God today what he has for you. Maybe you haven't. We didn't mention your name today, but the Lord knows your need, as we began earlier before we began to pray for the specific needs. Maybe you have a need today. Take it to the Lord and allow God to do his work in you and through you. Folks, as I was reflecting and thinking about this time in which we live, my heart has been heavy in the sense of knowing that a lot of folks that we know, a lot of people that we love, don't know Christ. They don't have Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. For whatever reason, they walked away from the Lord. Thank you, worship team. I appreciate what you folks have done this morning in leading us into the presence of God. These loved ones that we have, that we care about, that we cherish. Thinking of a dear sister who shared with us recently that her children, for whatever reason, have chosen not to follow Christ, and her grandchildren likewise. And her heart that is broken as a result of it. Let me share with you something. Hold fast to your prayers that God will touch your family member. Don't give up. There are times that mothers have gone to their graves, grandmothers have gone to their graves at an advanced age, and they did not see the answer to their prayers. But God worked and moved. I think of this one young man. He was 17 years old, a basketball player. And he wanted to see his family and his friends come to know Christ as his Lord, as their Lord and Savior. And he said, Lord, whatever it takes, reach them with the truth of Jesus Christ. The young man was playing in a game. He went up for a rebound, and he collapsed to the ground. And he died on the spot. It was a heart attack, a rupture. And he died almost instantaneously. And at the funeral, which was held by his pastor who was speaking, there was a lot of people in that audience that did know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And that pastor preached the gospel message, and many of his family members and many of his friends gave their hearts to Jesus because of the testimony of that young man and, more importantly, the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ in their lives. Don't give up. Sometimes, can I ask myself even, am I willing to pray such an audacious prayer, Father, whatever it takes, save my loved one, save my friends, save my family members. May God help us to have faith to believe him to do great things. Folks, I was thinking about this morning's message and saying, Lord, I need to know what you want me to share. I need to know in the time and age in which we live, we need to know what God's word says about the issues that we're facing as a nation and even as individuals. We need to know how to live as light in the darkness. I talked about that, preached about that several months ago, about being light and salt in this world. And that's what we need to be. But we have to, before we can become light and salt, we have to know what God's word says about the things that we are living and experiencing today. This is sort of like a pre-introduction to the message that I'm going to be preaching this morning and this evening, and it will carry on in a series of messages that will follow. This pre-introduction is just to give you an idea of the type of battle, spiritual battle, that we are in. Did you know that in 1980, the Supreme Court made it illegal for schools to post the Ten Commandments? That was only 7 years after abortion was passed and women could get abort children up to a certain age. 7 years later, the Ten Commandments were taken out of our public schools. Now, I know some schools for several years kept the Ten Commandments up. I saw a couple of them as a substitute teacher. But the majority of schools had taken them down. The Ten Commandments, if I can say this, are the basis for civil society. Civil society based upon God's words. And the Ten Commandments are not the only laws that God gave the people of Israel in the book of Exodus, but they are the Ten Commandments that serve as a basis for civil society. Well, do you know that in the same year, 1980, there was a monolith, a large stone structure, built in Georgia and in Ebertown. Let me just make sure I'm pronouncing this correctly here. It's in Elberton, Georgia. There's this monolith that was created of six large granite stones. No one seems to know who paid for it. No one seems to know who or who created the message that was written on these stones. They're called the Georgia Guidestones. Look it up on Google. Just Google Georgia Guidestones, and you'll find it. And you'll see the monolith, and you'll actually have a chance to see the writing on the monoliths. You see, the monoliths have what they consider their 10 commandments for future society. Their 10 dictates for future society. And the very first one is scary. And this is written not only in English, but in 12 different languages, including English, six of them being ancient languages that are no longer spoken today, and six of them modern languages that are spoken today. Etched on each side of these six granite stones that has a cap on the top. Again, you can go and find it, and you can see it. The first message, the first point, these 10 points that they make is maintain humanity under 500 million people in perpetual balance with nature. Folks, I'm not talking, this is not Star Wars stuff. This, you can actually go on there and you can see the monolith and you can see the up close of the words that are etched in it. And this is the first thing: maintain humanity under 500 million people in perpetual balance with nature. Guide reproduction wisely, improving fitness and diversity. This is what's written. That's the number two point. Number three, unite humanity in a living new language. A living new language. Rule passion, faith, tradition, and all things with tempered reason. Rule passion, faith, tradition, with tempered, and all things with tempered reason. In other words, we're going to control what you believe. We need to control what this 500 million people that they want to have in this world, and we're going to control what they believe and what motivates them. Number five, protect people and nations with fair laws and just courts. We could say, well, that's something we need. Let all nations rule internally, resolving external disputes in a world court. Sounds like some of the things that are being pushed today more and more. Avoid petty laws and useless officials. We could say, yes, indeed, let that be the case. Balance personal rights with social duties. In other words, society and your responsibilities to society are number one, and your personal rights are secondary. Prize truth, beauty, love, seeking harmony with the infinite. You can only imagine who the infinite represents to them that had this monolith erected. And be not a cancer on the earth. Leave room for nature. Leave room for nature. Now, why am I starting this off as a pre-introduction? Folks, if you don't think we're in a real battle here in the world, a real battle between what's right and what's wrong, between, right now we have almost 8 billion people, if not over 8 billion people, that populate this planet. What would have to happen for a population to be reduced to 500 million people? Pandemics? Weaponized biological? Choosing certain people as valid and those who are not valid or needful and eradicating them? You see, what we're seeing here and what's happening, and if this wasn't a real monument, it was just fake, that would be scary. But the Georgia tourist website has this as one of their places to go to. You can look it up on the Georgia tourism site and you can find it, the Guidestones of Georgia. It's one of the in the research engine or search engine, you can find it. This type of attitude that says we need to become balanced with nature. We need to be in perpetual balance. And what that says here is that we choose who has value and who doesn't. And those are the ones that get to live. And the rest, well, we're just purging the earth of the imbalance. It's scary. When you think that there are powerful people, they don't know, it's interesting, that they don't know who paid to have this erected. Some group, apparently, that had quite a bit of power and quite a bit of an ability to maintain their not knowing or revealing who they are, and they erected this. Now, some people have some particular theories about who did it. I'm not going to jump into that. All I know is that there's a great battle going on between good and evil in our world today. They talk about laws, just laws, and righteous laws for everyone else, but not for them. Folks, we see that happening so much today where there are individuals that have broken the law time and again, and they get off scot-free. They get a pass because they're an important person. God help us. We see that happening in our world today, and it makes our hearts shudder at the fact that the laws that would throw me in prison for a lifetime are laws that those who have power and resources and money can commit whenever and however, and they continue to live in their freedom. And those are things that we are seeing today. I used to think that the corruption that we saw in Haiti was out in your face. It was there. The politicians grabbing for money, this, that, and the other. I thought, America, we're above that. But in reality, when we came home from the mission field, we began to see the same thing happening, not only in America, but in the Western world, which represents civilized society to the world. May God help us. May God help us. That was just a pre-introduction. Folks, look it up and understand that we are in a battle. I'm not doing this to scare you, but I want you to realize that this is not something that is just by chance, the stuff that we're seeing. We're living in a battle where people are endeavoring to control the narrative, to control the story, to control you and I and humanity. May God help us. Today, as Christians, we are faced with ethical decisions every day. Now, what does ethics mean? It means knowing how to determine what is right and what is wrong, what is good and what is bad. That's what ethics is. Now, are there different types of ethics? Yes, there are. There are many types, and we'll deal with that in a little bit. The questions that we may ask ourselves every day would be something like this. Will I choose to lie in order to save face or advance my cause? Will I choose to cheat in order to get ahead, to climb the ladder? Will I choose to gossip? Will I choose purity over lust or lust over purity? Will I allow anger to consume me? Will I choose forgiveness or harbor bitterness? Will I choose to obey the authorities so long as they don't infringe upon what I consider my personal rights are? I'm not talking about laws that are written, that our nation has established as our governing principles. I'm talking about people who have ideas about their personal rights that are not based upon any given laws. Do I have the right to choose to obey or disobey authorities? Will I place my personal rights above others? Will I choose to do just enough to get by at work? I remember when I was working in a factory as a young man, shortly after Cynthia and I were married, a light pole factory just right out here by the fairgrounds. That factory, from my understanding, is no longer in existence, as far as not in existence as a telephone light pole factory. But I remember the guy next to me as we were working on this line, and we were filling all the interior parts of this structure, this great mold that we would clap down and that we would, and we had to do five a day. Five was the goal and what the management asked us to do. And I talked to the gentleman to my left, and I said, why do you only do just five? Because I had only been there shortly, and I was doing six, seven. And he said simply, I do just enough to get by. I do just the minimum of what is required. And I thought, you know what? I am representing more than just myself. I am representing Christ, and I should work with everything that's in me and to do the best job that I possibly can in what I do. Will I choose to love others, or will I choose to hate them? Will I choose to value life? Will I choose to honor God with my attitudes and actions? And the list seemingly is endless, and in some ways it is, because we face different circumstances and situations every day of our life. How can we make ethical decisions in this sea of questions that we are constantly faced with? This is something that is important for us. How do we do that? Before we look at the answer to that question, it is important to understand how the world outside of Christ makes ethical decisions. Well, how does the world make their decisions? What do they base their decisions upon? You know, for centuries, philosophers have debated over what is the basis for ethical action, or the basis for choosing what is right and what is wrong. One such philosophy that was put forth by the Greek philosopher Thrasymachus, a really difficult name to pronounce, is might makes right. Might makes right. According to this idea, justice is in the interest of the stronger party. Right is defined in terms of power. This includes political power, and you've heard the word the Machiavelli type of seizure of power, physical, psychological, or any other kind of power. The problem with this idea that might makes right is that most see a difference between power and goodness. One can be good without power, and one can be powerful without goodness. You've heard the adage, power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Absolutely. So there are those that believe if they have the power, they have the right to make the rules. And they make the rules because they have the power to enforce the rules that they make. And everybody has to bow down to them. There are those in the world who are like that today. It doesn't take us long to go back into the history of humanity over the last century of seeing people that have risen to power. We could say that many of these would be the dictator types that would rise up and by the force of their power and their means to enforce their power upon others have determined laws and how their populations are to live. And if they don't, they suffer the consequences of those decisions. Another view is morals are mores. Let me explain. Right is determined by the group to which one belongs. So if you belong to a certain tribe or to a certain family, let's start with family, tribe, could be here in America, I'm Texan, I'm Californian, I'm this or I'm that. Right and wrong is determined by the group to which one belongs. Ethics is identified with the ethnic, with one's upbringing, with one's own ethnic background. Moral commands are considered community demands. Now, we see that sometimes in the idea that in a particular community, it could be in a family too, we have certain expectations of behavior from our family members, and then we take it to the larger community from our community members, and it's not necessarily totally always wrong. The problem is whatever a group believes to be right is right, even to the point of annihilating another group. Now, we see that particularly in places like South America and also in some places in Africa, where tribal people have no problem killing people from another tribe and attacking them and taking whatever they want. But you know what? In a way, we see that even in our own time, where even at a national level, people have a certain way of thinking that permits them to behave in such a way that they think is right, when in reality, their right is someone else's wrong. Another view is man is the measure. Man is the measure of all things. This philosophy comes from Protagoras, an ancient Greek philosopher. He said, man is the measure of all things. If this is taken in an individual sense, then right is measured by an individual's will. What is right for me is right for me. What is right for one may be wrong for another. And that's where the problem is. This problem leads to chaos. Folks are sort of seeing that happen right now in our own country, in the cities. What makes it right for someone to take a brick and throw it through the window of a building and go in there and begin to take what he wants? What gives him the right to do that? Well, in his own mind, he thinks he has the right because of some perceived offense or because some perceived, or let's just put it this way, he wants what's there. He has a pretext for action. He breaks the window and goes in along with others and pillages a store, or destroys a store, or sets cars on fire. Man is the measure, and it leads to chaos. Every person does that which is right in their own eyes. Every person does that which is right in their own eyes. Another view is the race, talking about the ethnicity is right. Neither individuals or individual communities are the measure of right, but rather, in this situation, the whole human race is the final court of appeal. The problem with this view is that it leads to ambiguity because the whole human race is in a constant state of change, and what's right in one country could be wrong in another country. Dégagez pas péché. It's an expression in Creole. To get by is not to sin. So if your friend has two of the same thing, you take one, it's not sin. Now, we call that stealing in America because it doesn't belong to you and you didn't pay for it. But there, it's perfectly accepted by a lot of people. A friend of ours who now is living in the United States with her husband and her children, when her father passed away, she had to hide everything in their home that had any value at all. Because the family was coming over. They were going to have dinner there. I even imagine they went to paper plates and plastic nice forks and spoons. Because the cutlery would have disappeared into purses and items would have disappeared into bags and into jackets or whatever. You see, what's acceptable in one nation may not be acceptable in another nation. And so the race is right. The human race is able to judge. It changes too often, and it fluctuates too often to be something that would be a foundation upon which to base our decisions, right and wrong decisions on. Another view is right is moderation. This is Aristotle's baby here. He was the well-known Greek philosopher. He advanced this idea that the meaning of right is found in the path of moderation. No, it's all about moderation. This approach to ethical decisions is one that takes the middle of the road. Moderate Democrats, moderate Republicans, middle of the road people. They don't know. They're trying to find a balance somehow in there. And so right is moderation. Let me just give you this example. Now, I know that there may be some listening that have a different view than I, and that's between you and the Lord. But for me, I don't drink, and I have my reasons why I don't drink. And for me, there is no moderation. If I were to drink a little or drink moderately, well, you know what? I know Steve. That if I liked it, there's no moderation. Now, some of you might say, well, you just don't have discipline, Steve. Well, maybe in those certain situations, yes. But when I see the damage and the destruction that alcohol brings into people's lives, I want to stay as far away from it as possible. The Word of God is very clear, and the warnings are clear in God's Word. And I don't want to get close. I don't want to get close to it because it's like a viper that stings or bites, and it just doesn't bite once. It bites time and time and time again until utter destruction. And I'll have to say, I was raised in a family where, thankfully, my parents didn't drink, but my grandma did. And I remember the horror of her coming home blackout drunk and the awful things that she said, the awful things that she did. My brother was a big man. Now, you consider me big right now? Okay, I get it. I get that. But at that time, I was just a kid. And my brother was a big man. He was a Marine, and he was the top. He was what they called the leatherneck of his training squad in boot camp. He was the top of the top. And I saw him at 220 pounds, almost rock solid muscle. And he was shaking in the presence of my grandmother, who had a knife in her hand. My brother knew how to defend himself. But the thought of hurting a little 5'2" woman who was under the control of alcohol completely and totally. You see, for me, right is not contained in moderation. Just a little bit of immorality is okay. Moderation. Just a little bit of stealing is okay. A little bit of lying is okay. A little bit of this, a little bit of that, that's okay. No. The problem is that this view with this view is that it ignores the fact that reality often requires extreme measures in order to remedy a problem or crisis. There are a lot of things that require extreme measures. A country attacks another country. You're going to go defend that country, your own country's attacked. Are we going to respond in moderation while people are dying and being killed? See, that's what's happening in our cities. These rulers in these cities, these city politicians, oh, we're going to act with moderation. Buildings are being burned down. Even the news saying, oh, they're peacefully rioting. And in the back behind him, there's buildings on fire. This is what our Constitution is all about. Misleading a whole generation. Misleading people who have been in schools indoctrinated by professors that do not have the best interests of this nation at heart, but want to put forth an agenda that brings them into complete control of the population. Another view is there is no right. Some philosophers deny that anything is right or wrong. There's nothing that's right or wrong. Every ethical decision is relegated to one's personal feelings. The ought to is replaced by I feel like. The problem with this view is that feelings are fickle. They go up and they go down. They change constantly. They're in a constant state of flux. What is right today for me is wrong tomorrow for me. It's interesting, and I'll use this example because it's just so strikingly incredible, that the mayor of Chicago, who has been allowing rioting in her city, has then forbidden rioting in her own neighborhood. I'm sorry, that's something that shows me here that this woman doesn't really have right and wrong or based on the circumstance that she's living at the moment. And so she says, wait, yes, they can tear up downtown. They can tear up their business district. Where great stores that have represented our nation's culture have decided that they are not going to rebuild and they're moving out. But when they come to her neighborhood, that's where she draws the line. How many times have we heard that? Even the mayor of Seattle, when they went into her neighborhood or trying to get into her neighborhood, a wall of police that were preventing them from entering. And how we see that time and time and time again. There is no right or there is no wrong. It's based on I feel like. I feel like letting them riot because they have to express themselves. But don't come to my yard. Don't come to my house. Don't throw a Molotov cocktail at my home or at my car. There is no right. Another view is right is what brings pleasure. This philosophy emerged 4 centuries before Christ. The Epicureans had been credited with the original philosophy of hedonism. In a nutshell, hedonism claims that what brings pleasure is right and what brings pain is wrong. What brings pleasure is right and what brings pain is wrong. What brings the maximal pleasure and the minimal pain is the right thing to do. The problem with this view is not all pleasure is good, nor is all pain bad. You see, cancer is not good, but its remedy, surgery, or other treatments can be painful. So we say, that's wrong. We shouldn't have surgeries because it causes pain. We shouldn't have medication because it causes side effects. We shouldn't have this, we shouldn't have that. Because right is what brings pleasure. So if it brings me pleasure to go to another man's wife and say, hey, listen, let's shack up, because that brings me a whole lot of pleasure in my physical body, does it make it right? Well, according to this philosophy, yes. Do whatever I want. But then someone would say, no, but you're causing pain to the husband of that woman. You see here, who's sitting on the throne of one's own life? It's themselves. making their own arbitrary decisions of what is right and what is wrong, based on pleasure, based on other things. Another view is right is the greatest good for the race. Well, this attempts to make decisions based on the greatest good for everyone involved. In other words, we're going to pass this law because it's going to be good for everyone. And the question can then be asked, well, how do you know it's going to be good for everyone? Well, we'll have to wait and see. We'll have to wait and see. But we think this is, isn't it interesting how many people in political positions want to tell you how to live your life? They want to tell you how to act, how to behave, how to in every spectrum. You shouldn't drink Coca-Cola. You shouldn't drink Pepsi. I know, in reality, those things are not necessarily the best for our bodies. I get that. But they want to come to you and tell you what you can eat, what you can drink, where you can go, what you can do. These individuals want to control every aspect of your life. It's interesting that the former president's wife, and I think her intent, at least I hope it was relatively good, but trying to set menus in school cafeterias for kids, telling kids what they had to eat. Well, I can guarantee you that there was a lot of carrots and a lot of celery and a lot of other vegetables that went into the trash can, and they ate whatever they thought that they would like on that plate, trying to manipulate and control. Right is the greatest good for everybody. The problem is that how can one determine if a certain decision will produce the greatest good for all when the outcome is unknown? Another view is good is what is desired for its own sake. Good should never be desired as a means, but only as an end. The problem is the definition for good. Who defines it? Who determines what is good? For one, their idea of good may be evil to others, and vice versa. Might makes right, all these different things, I'm not going to repeat them, but all these different ways of thinking. Even one philosopher, G.E. Moore, insisted that good is indefinable. You can't define it. Good is known only intuitively. The problem is that not all people intuit the same content in good as good or right or good or bad. What I think is good, but if you think what I think is good is wrong, then there's no way to bridge the gap between us. To sum it all up, those who embrace any number of these philosophical ideas have a moral foundation that is like quicksand. There is no stability. What is good today is wrong tomorrow, and what is wrong today is good tomorrow. Good becomes evil, and evil becomes good. And that's where we're at in our particular society, bringing it back home to America. And we need God's help. And as Christians, we need to consider this. Right is the greatest good for the race. Let me come back to that. How many of you have ever heard of Peter Singer? Peter Singer was a philosopher, ethnician. Ethics is what his specialty was. And he wrote a book back in the 1950s that is still being largely used, albeit modified, updated, in a lot of universities where ethics is taught. What he teaches is that human value is based on productivity. Human value is based on productivity. Once one is no longer able to produce, they no longer have value, and thus should be eliminated. And this is a book that's being used in the majority of our universities today, or at least parts of it are being pushed. Human value is based on productivity. And he goes as far as to say that up until about 5 years of age, It's around 4 or 5 that you begin to understand the productivity potential of a human being. And if there is no sense or seeing of productivity, then their life should be ended so that society doesn't have to deal with them for the rest of their lives, even though you don't know what the future holds for that the individual. I have a grandson who has struggled to speak. He's 4 years old now, and it's starting to happen. He might be considered one of those who had no potential productivity in his life, and by this type of thinking, be marginalized or eliminated. Why? Because they don't want to pay to take care of them. And then imagine those who are handicapped or ill, have a terminal disease. You see, you're thinking right now, I know some of you are thinking, oh, come on, Pastor Steve, this doesn't happen in our world. All we have to go back is 75 years ago in Germany. You see, Mr. Hitler felt that there were certain human beings that he considered subspecies that didn't have any value. He emptied out all of his mental hospitals. He emptied out all of his hospitals where people were handicapped and were being taken care of. He emptied out all the nursing homes of the elderly because they were dead weight on their society and he no longer wanted to pay for it. You see, some of this history is not spoken. We talk about the war, we talk about the SS, we talk about all this stuff. But there were literally hundreds of thousands of Germans who lost their lives, if not millions, as a result of this ethnic cleansing and purification. That happened. You know, people like to say that America's fascist now. If you're listening and you believe that, you don't understand what fascism is. I'm sorry. You don't understand what it is at all. Fascism doesn't value life. Who doesn't value life in our own nation? Those on the left. Those on the left. One of the things that we're going to be dealing with in the days ahead is abortion. What does God's word say about abortion? Now, if anyone listening has had an abortion, this is not a condemnation session. This is just to show you from God's word what God's word says about that particular thing. We live in a world that is topsy-turvy right now. We live in a world where things are upside down. As Christians, we have to be strong in what we believe based upon God's word. Based upon God's word. You might be thinking, even still after all this, you might be thinking, why is this all so important? I just want to live my life, earn my money, take care of my family, and everything's cool. We need to know that there is a reality around us. Those who were living in the different countries of Europe, in World War I and World War II, they were living their lives. They were providing for their family. They were working until their neighborhoods, until their cities, their towns, their farms were overrun by military forces that were bent on their destruction. Philosophies that are out there that are damning for eternity. And we need God's help to discern what is right and what is wrong. We need to know what God's word says so that we can make the ethical decisions that are based not on these assumptions that I've just enumerated to you, but based upon God's word. That's what we need to do with God's help. Tonight, we will continue. And we will come back to the question that I asked at the beginning. How can we make ethical decisions in the sea of questions, or sea, as I would like to say here, of shifting ideas? God's word gives us direct commands that should impact our ethical decisions. And his word gives us principles that can help us to make ethical decisions that are not directly addressed or dealt with in the Bible. Pentecostal Christians, if you're listening in, evangelical Christians, this book is to be our guide, not some guide stone in the middle of a field in Georgia, Elberton, Georgia. This book is to be our guide. And with the Lord's help, tonight we'll look at it and we'll give you some parameters. We'll look at God's natural revelation, and we'll look at God's special revelation. We'll go into detail of how these two things, how humanity is all responsible to God for what he reveals to humanity in his nature, in his creation, and also in his word. I'm going to close there. What I've shared with you is heavy. Yes, I get that, and I understand that, but absolutely necessary because we live in a world that's difficult. So over the next several weeks, we're going to be hitting issues. We're going to be talking about euthanasia. We're going to be talking about God's perspective on abortion. We're going to be talking on God's perspective about moral purity according to God's word. We're going to be talking about marriage. We're going to be talking about divorce. We're going to be talking about a lot of different things. Now, please don't come prepared, pastor's going to judge me. That's not the issue. What's past is past. We can't go back and change what's been done, but we can live and move forward into what God has for us in our future. And that's the thing that's so important. We're going to be talking about other things as well. I don't have the complete list here. I wrote it down in my office, and I have it there. And we're going to be developing this Sunday morning, and Sunday night, over the month of September. We'll have a little break there when Mikael will be coming and sharing the word with us. As well, but I just want you to know that these things are important to know what God's word says and not what man says and not what man purports to believe. I've come to a point, and I'll close with this, I've come to a point where I can't even trust the politicians in the party that I belong to politically because they have spoke a lot and have done little. Now, there are some who are trying to make progress, and I'm thankful for our president. He's not your politician. He's a businessman that has seen a need, and he's focusing largely on the issues of finance, and that's all important. And he does make statements regarding the value of life, the value of human life, and things of that nature, which I'm so thankful for, and his vice president, Vice President Pence, and those others who belong to the Republican Party, not all of them, but folks, there's been so much wrangling going on, so much talk, speak. That's the thing, when President Trump said, these are the goals that I have that I'm going to aim for if I become president, he has endeavored, with all the obstacles and all the opposition that he's had, he has endeavored to walk that road. Now, has he been perfect? No. Like a lot of people would wish, maybe he shouldn't tweet so much. But whatever your feeling is on that, at least you know who he is. He's right out there. He's not hiding anything, at least not from what we can see. And he's endeavoring to do what he feels is best for the country. And I'm thankful for that. Our vote this coming November should not be based upon personalities. It shouldn't be based on good looks. It shouldn't be based on savvy, the ability to communicate. It should be based on what we believe God's word holds to be eternal truths. And if a particular politician is against those eternal truths, then we need to vote for someone else. And I'll be honest with you, in my past, I voted for a Democrat over a Republican because the Republican was a fiscal conservative financially, but a social liberal, talking about everything else. And the Democrat was fiscally liberal, but a social conservative. Finances go up and down. Our nation, one month can have a great year, or one year have a great year, the next year struggle. But what's at the heart of the matter, if that goes south, then our nation won't stand. It cannot stand the weight of sin and sinful behavior. God help us all. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word, and I ask that your Holy Spirit would work in our hearts and lives. God, I know that I've given sort of an introduction to what we're going to dive into tonight in your word, and then in the subsequent weeks ahead. And God, it is my prayer that your people would follow. There are those out there in this world that seek the destruction of humanity and the dismantling of faith, and particularly dismantling of the Christian faith. Because you, Lord Jesus, are our Lord and King. before presidents, before kings on this earth, you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we worship you and we bow down before you and no one else. Lord, it is my prayer that in the name of Jesus, you would help us to discern the times in which we live, as the men of Issachar did in the Old Testament. They discerned the times in which they lived. We need to be people of discernment. And God, help me as a pastor of this congregation to teach and preach your word in such a way that would enable your children to discern what is right and what is wrong according to your word. God, I pray that this week would be a great week for each one. A great week in this sense that they sense your presence, they feel your heartbeat, Lord, they're spending time with you. And God, that you would communicate your love and grace to their lives. I pray your blessing upon everyone. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Folks, we love you. Don't forget about this evening at 6 o'clock. You can join us on our Facebook page, Chowchilla First Assembly of God. I want to encourage you to hear the second half because it's important. It'll continue. This right now, we're laying the foundation for what we're going to do and teach in the future. If you're not able to watch it tonight for whatever reason, watch it because it's on Facebook and you'll be able to watch it. And I want to encourage you to do that. Don't forget about Wednesday night. For the Bible study, and also pray for Ruth and Mikael that they'll have no glitches when they get on that plane Friday their time in Paris, and that they would be able to make it all the way to San Francisco on time with no hiccups or anything between there and San Francisco. We love you, folks. Have a great week. May the Lord's blessing be upon you. God bless.